किसका आवाज नहीं आ रहा है? तेरा टट्टी इंटरनेट है, टट्टी इंटरनेट चेंज करवा।
Oh, okay. Sorry, I have muted my microphone. So, now there are only 50 people right now. That's around half the class. Okay, so I'm going to give the number of the participants to your course director, so course instructor. So I think that thank you, Amin. Thank you, Aman. Yes.
Morning,
So I think it'll be better if you tell your friends to join soon, okay? So we'll wait because there's only half the class right now. And I want to see the ladies' faces. Because what I've noticed is that only the guys have spoken up. So can I see your faces? I can see Geeta Priya's name there. I can see Chiasa. I can see Ladusaki. So can I all see your faces, please? Geeta. Okay, thank you.
morning,
So
guys.
I can see Chiasa, Ladusaki. Are you all there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So I would encourage all the ladies to speak up also, okay? So there are 53 of you are right now, so please call your friends and ask them to join. Okay? We will not start until the required attendance is fulfilled. Now, while we're waiting for your friends, is there anything like generally in what we have discussed or something else that you would like to ask me or you'd like to talk about regarding your courses? Please feel free to speak up, okay? And I encourage all the Naga students also to take part. The Nagaland students, I mean, the Nagaland College students. So please, if there's anything you'd like to discuss or ask or, anything about wildlife or conservation or veterinary research in wildlife, you can please feel free to tell me. Am I audible?
Yes,
Yes,
ma'am.
ma'am.
I can't hear your voices. Am I
Ma'am.
audible? Oh, something is wrong. I can't hear your voices. Have you muted yourself? Something is wrong there. Okay, guys, I can't hear your voice. Can anyone just speak up just so that I'll change my settings?
Hello, ma'am. Hello, can you hear us, ma'am?
Okay, sorry. Yes, there was some problem with my laptop. So there are only 59 people. Where are your other friends? Yes, I think I'll rejoin. Okay, I'll just leave. Okay, so now I wanna, if you can hear me, I wanna know if I can hear your voices. All right, thank you, Oman. So there are only 59 people, there are supposed to be 70 people. Can you please, yeah, now there's 60 people, can you please call your friends? Joshua, is Joshua there? Is Eddie B there?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell me who are the absentees?
I'm not sure, ma'am. About 30 from us.
Yeah, so Eddie B, are you there? Anyone from Nagaland College?
Actually, I think we have some network issues.
So who is the assistant CR?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, so how many students are absent from your college?
Yeah, ma'am.
Hmm?
Ma'am, 2 or 4.
Yes, please call them up, okay? So I'll start with the presentation right now. Yeah. So today we're gonna learn a very interesting topic. It's going to get more and more technical from here on, okay? So I just want to know whether you have had your nutrition courses. Anyone answer me?
Yes, ma'am.
Pardon?
Ma'am, repeat the question.
Am I not audible?
Yes, ma'am, your voice is breaking.
Okay, so I want to know whether you have done your nutrition courses. Okay,
no,
you have not done.
No,
you're in your first semester, right? Dobby, stop. My dog is disturbing me today. Okay, so today we're gonna talk about a very interesting topic. So it's going to get more and more technical from now on. So I think we'll need a little bit of your attention, okay? And it's going to be interesting because these are going to be very useful for you once you become a veterinary officer or a veterinary surgeon in the even in the department as well, because in the State Department, because you might be posted, get to be posted in a zoo or, you know, like I've said before. So I think these are the things that you need to know before that, okay? So I'll just share with you. Can you all see my screen? Okay. you guys are interactive enough, from next class onwards, I'll show you my photographs, okay? My photographs of while I am in my doing my job and everything, okay? So let's see if that's possible. Now, we're going to study today the principles of zoo nutrition, which mainly encompasses feeding habits, feeds, and feeding schedules of captive animals. Now, it becomes really, really technical when we're going to go... Dobby, no, no. Anita, please. Dobby, hello. Because it becomes really technical, so I'm going to go with the basic principles, all right? Because you haven't done your nutrition course, so you wouldn't know how to calculate the nutritional requirements yet, and all those things are needed. So I can't deal with all the principles and those nitty-gritties in one class. So we're going to go in a very general way, and I'm going to explain to you the fundamentals of feeding habits and feeds and feeding schedules of captive animals, okay? Now... What are the objective of feeding management? Like, now we all know that, you know, species have evolved to occupy niches in habitats in which they occur, with the level of adaptations varying in each species, okay? And some have evolved specializations which are unique to their particular habitats, and while others are more adaptable and they survive in broad range of habitat types. Now, free-ranging animals thrive by achieving control over their environment via their regulatory and behavioral adjustments. Now, in captive conditions, an animal loses control over its environment, right? So it is impossible to include the infinite variables that exist for them in free-ranging situations. Now, that's why the objective of captive feeding managements are to provide the best nutrition as close to natural feeding and foraging as possible. That will determine their health, their growth, and their longevity, and also maintain their healthy cycle of reproduction, and also maintain their behavioral normality. All right. Now, therefore, so in order to achieve all these objectives, there are certain conditions to consider, all right? That is a descriptive and characteristic of the species. Like I said, all species have evolved in their own niches, to occupy their own niches in natural habitats. And they have evolved those specializations so that they can survive in those habitats, right? So to achieve... the objectives that I've mentioned before, these are the certain points we have to consider, and the natural feeding ecology, all right? Now, why do we need to do that? Because in captivity, animals lose control over their environment, okay, which I've just explained before, which they are capable of in free-ranging conditions via regulatory and behavioral adjustments. That they cannot choose what they eat, they cannot roam to forage, all right? So therefore, conditions in captivity, we know very little about their environmental requirements or species which are still under study, and their behavioral ecology from studies in free-ranging conditions are still minimal, all right? Therefore, nutritional requirement based on their category, their species and sex, and providing enrichments to mimic natural feeding and behavior to minimize the stress are really important. Now, do any one of you know what an enrichment is? I can't see the message, so you have to speak out, okay? And I cannot see your faces. I can see only my screen. So you don't need to feel embarrassed or anything. So does anyone know what an enrichment means? You can all hear me, right? Am I audible? Okay. I feel like I see only Aman responding.
ma'am, increasing the value or quality.
Yes, yes. Very right. So we'll go more into the specific details of enrichments later on, okay? Now, we're going to go directly into the principles of nutritional management in zoo animals. Now, formulating appropriate diets for each animal, not only nutritionally, but also in relation to the animal's physiology and morphology of the digestive tract, its foraging ecology and behavior is very important. That's why it will depend on what category of animals they are, whether they're herbivores, omnivores, or carnivores, right? Now, these are a very, 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 very broad category. So under these, we need to also formulate the nutritional requirements based on the specific needs of the species, because the selection of specific food items, depending upon what specific species they are, will be very important, right? Now, we're going to go into nutritional supplements. You know that, you know, these days, nutritional supplements, you know, it's a huge business in human nutrition as well. So I think most of you know what nutritional supplement is, so I don't have to explain it to you. Now, the use of nutritional supplements is also very popular among animal caretakers, okay? So although many keepers and pet owners use nutritionally complete feeds that require no supplementation, but we still often require supplements. The nutrient content of the current diet should be established or estimated first to determine whether any supplement is needed or whether supplement should be discontinued. Okay. Now, unfortunately, diets are rarely evaluated first to determine which nutrients are unbalanced. So if a nutrient is found to be deficient in a diet, a specific supplement in a specific amount should be recommended. Okay. Now, we cannot give excessive supplementation of some nutrients, example, some fat soluble vitamins, selenium, copper, because they can cause toxicity when they are given in excess and results in nutrient imbalance, which can be have a very detrimental effect on the animal as well. Okay. Now, diets consisting primarily of grain products and cultivated fruits and vegetables may need micronutrient supplementation. However, supplements vary widely in their composition. Now, how do we account for the need for dietary change? How do we know that, this diet is not suitable for this particular animal or species? We have done something wrong here. Now, how do we account for the dietary changes? Now, formulating the required nutritional requirement can be very tricky because it also involves the palatability of the food items selected for a particular species, which means that, you might have an exotic species in your zoo, right? And there might have been a formulation of, okay, we need this much calcium, we need this much protein, we need this much crude fiber, we need this much micronutrients, and so on and so forth. So you might have the formulation for that, okay? And you might have gathered the food items which will make up for those nutritional requirements that you have calculated or formulated out. But the food items available for that might not suit the species palatability, which means that the particular species you're looking after might not find it tasty, or, you know, it's not something that it wants to eat. So many times dietary changes are also required, and in these situations they cause nutritional imbalances. And in these situations, establishing and maintaining recording dietary histories can be particularly helpful, okay? So like I said, so when those dietary changes are necessary, how do we know? When we suspect nutrient imbalances, when we find deficiencies, when we find toxicities, like I said before, giving excess of micronutrients and other nutritional supplements also can cause toxicities in excess. And when the animal is suspected of confirmed health problem, including that may not be linked to nutrition, right? So an example, not only metabolic disorders, but other, you know, diseases that the animal is found to be having, you kind of started to find some symptom of some disease in the animal. So that means that, you know, the animal might need, you know, more or less of, require more or less of certain nutritional food items, right? So in that, you have to discern your way by that, make your opinions by that. I mean, make, and for this, when you maintain the dietary history, that means what you have given, what you have formulated, when you have a proper history of that, it becomes very helpful for you, okay? Now, how do we do that? Now, we can do that by keeping track of the dietary history, all right? Now, it's very important here. I want you to all pay attention here to diet drift, okay? Now, this keeping the track of dietary history is very important to prevent diet drift. Now, what is diet drift? Diet drift is the changes in the diet consumed because it is not regularly weighed, right? So, while providing feed to zoo animals, they weigh the feed every day, okay? They weigh the feed regularly. The dietary intake is the weight of the feed minus the leftovers, so you can, so that you may know that how much the animal has consumed, right? So you give 3 kgs of fruits, different types of fruits to an animal, and then there are certain leftovers, so you go and take them again and weigh them again, so you have, so you can know how much the animal has consumed, and thereby you can track the nutritional consumption of the animal, right? More or less. Now, it should be determined at least 3 times a year. This is very important, so I want you to remember this: diet drift and dietary intake. All right. Now, we can also do a body condition score and a fecal score, and it should be recorded 3 times per year, but you should do it more regularly than this. This is as per the guidelines, but I believe that in most zoos, they do it much, much more regular than this, okay? By the animal keeper and 2 independent experts, such as a veterinarian and a nutritionist. Now, a body condition score is when you, there are certain guidelines for doing body condition scoring for certain animals, species. So a body condition score is when you look at the animal and you determine their rump part, you know, you determine the muscles, you determine the fat, and you score the animal accordingly, whether they're normal, whether they're obese, or, you know, whether they're healthy, they're emaciated, they're heavily emaciated. So a body condition scoring can be very helpful because it's non-invasive, which means that you don't have to go and poke the animal with a needle or a syringe or take any invasive samples. And fecal score is also important, okay? So you can, by it's done by observing the feces of the animal. Actually, the feces or scats of the animal can tell us a lot about the health of the animal and the general status of the animal, okay? And also the general status of the animal, whether they're pregnant, they're old, they're young, they're sick, should also always be recorded, all right? Now we're talking about nutrition and the principles of zoo nutrition. Now what about water, right? Water is so essential, and animals also can't live without it, right? It's not that they don't drink water, they need water as much as human beings. So many animals in the world consume much of their water through the food they eat, all right? So when low moisture food are consumed, that means when food having lesser water are consumed, like pellets and extrusions, some animals, depending upon whether water is present, may not maintain adequate hydration, right? So, but in the wild, in free ranging animals, let's, for example, small and tropical lizards receive water from foods and from licking the drops of water that accumulate after rainfall on the leaves, okay? But when in captivity, they frequently do not drink readily from containers because that's not how they do it in the natural habitats. And in nature, birds of prey do not drink. However, in captivity, they do drink. Birds of prey means like eagles, owls, you know, predator birds. But in captivity, they do drink sometimes, and depending upon the circumstances, so clean drinking water must be available at all times. Okay, that is, potable water should be available ad libitum. Ad libitum means at all times and as much as they want. Okay, now water intake should also be assessed regularly, because especially in animals with compromised renal function, kidney function, okay, especially in lizards or birds that are prone to gout, and in animals under conditions of high temperature, low humidity, in which evaporative losses can be expected, okay, so it should be assessed routinely. Now this, it's very important to also know the salt content of water, because some species are less tolerant than others. Okay, they are not the same. They are different types of species, and you should know the physiology and the natural ecology of the species. That's why it's very important to know that. Now, animals fed dry feed like pellets or extrusions or hay, they require more than those that are fed succulent feeds. Okay. Now, humidity may be especially important to maintain hydration, especially if you're maintaining reptiles in your zoo, especially lizards that may be observed to drinking standing water. Like I said, some animals are only used to drinking water from the leaf drops, you know, the water droplets from the leaves, and also for them, it's a completely unnatural and an alien thing to drink water from a standing bowl or a container. Okay, so that means that those animals need extra observation. You need to observe them carefully so that you know how much water they have consumed. All right, now we're talking about feeding enrichment. Now, what is feeding enrichment, right? So feeding enrichment is one of the categories of zoo enrichment. Now, these are the category of zoo enrichment: social, cognitive, physical habitat, sensory, food. Now, we're dealing with only the food part here. But since all these parts are going to be missed, and then they're very important, especially when it comes to zoo housing and designing of a zoo enclosure, and designing the management and layout of the zoo, it's really important. So I'll just give a brief explanation of this. Now, a social enrichment would be the presence of conspecifics, interspecific people or others. Cognitive will be mental stimulation, their novel experience. Now, physical habitat would be like, for example, if you keep a bird that's used to perching or climbing, or, you know, animals that used to climbing. So you keep some climbing structures, you know, you keep some places where they can perch. Like, for example, in bear enclosures, they usually keep some places where they can climb and some places where they can scratch and all, right? Or substrates. You provide nest and den for animals who normally in natural conditions live in nest and dens. Provide refuges so that, you know, some animals like to hide away during the day or during the night. And also maybe provide climate gradients. Like, for example, especially when you house these amphibians, like, for example, I rescued, like, long time back when I was a master's student, I rescued a soft-shell Indian peacock turtle, okay? So that animal particularly needs a place where it can freely go towards dry land and also dip itself in water, okay? Because it burrows itself in the sand during the midday when it's hot and all. So you need to provide for that. And during winters, the animal actually also hibernates there. So those kind of climate gradients need to be provided for certain animals. And most people right now in Northeast also are very used to keeping these turtles and tortoises and, you know, so amphibians. So I think that it's very important to maintain a climate gradient for them. Now, sensory might be tactile, it might be olfactory, smell, gustatory, taste, auditory, hearing, or visual, all right? But now we're going to deal mainly with enrichment categories feeding enrichment. Okay, so what is feeding enrichment? Feeding enrichment is the enrichment that involves either presenting varied or novel food types. Okay, you're presenting variety of new food every now and then, or you change the food types or change the method of food delivery. Okay, now free-ranging animals, they spend the maximum part of their daily active time either feeding or searching for food, right? They roam around all the time. But in captivity, this urge is severely thwarted by the fixed feeding schedule that we have, okay, and altered diets. Now, natural feeding or foraging behavior, when you inculcate that, it becomes really helpful. But how do we do that? It can be done by a variety of means, like, you know, concealed feeding, you know, scattered feeding, which means that you can scatter the feed using the different areas of the paddock, you know, or the frequency of feeding at the enclosure often affects the welfare of animals in number of ways. Feed frequency can also be modulated by providing various feed enrichments such as concealed and scattered feeding across the paddock to promote natural foraging patterns. Okay, such enrichments can be beneficial for all types of taxa and increase the daily time spent in foraging. For example, if you feed your animal, okay, it's 7 o'clock, we need to feed our tiger. If you do that every day, that's going to have some effect on the animal, right? In simple terms. Now, so that is very necessary, and captive animals are almost always fed in the same area of the enclosure, which creates a high level of cognitive association with the animal with a particular location. So when the animal is allowed to access the feeding location, displacement behaviors are more likely to occur. Okay, therefore, by feeding the animals at different locations of the paddock area, you enable a positive relationship with the entire enclosure the environment is created. Now, in captivity, animals are often fed with the same diet, right? With the same diet, which creates a sense of monotony, all right? So food choices for free-ranging animals are seasonally dependent for animals which are free-ranging in the wild. And they can choose as per the season. And therefore, to bring in a diversity that is essential for the maintenance of species-specific traits is important. So we can rotate major food items in the diet of captive animals, and it creates some novelty, you know, it creates that newness that can improve health and enhance their cognitive skills through the effort required for processing complex food items. And the rotation in food items is mostly relevant for herbivores, primates, ursids, and small animals. All right. Now, what are the types of feeding enrichments that you can apply? You know, examples of feeding enrichment. This is really, really important. Now, hollow feeding logs can be placed at different locations of the enclosure to conceal food items and other enrichments. Now, you can keep your the food items that you're going to feed, hide it inside a log so that the animal can search for it. And, you know, it enhances or it triggers their natural behavior of foraging or searching for food in the wild, right? Now, most animals such as primates, ursids, and small mammals have a good repertoire of exploratory behavior. They have an exploratory behavior. They like to explore, that they can utilize to extract food from complex enrichment devices. Okay. Now, honey dispensers, I have mentioned here. So honey is a natural and highly sought after. Just one second. So we're almost to the end of our presentation. Okay, it's been only half an hour, so please bear with me. So honey, I've kept honey dispenser here. Honey is a natural and highly sought after food resource for more wild animals, especially ursids, which means the bear family. Okay, however, in the wild, as you know, acquired honey has a significant cost on the animal, right? Like bee sting, and they have to go and search for it, climb a tree. So in captive conditions, when you just feed the animal honey, like you just keep it in a container there, it becomes very easy for the animal to access. It doesn't enhance or trigger any of their natural behavior, right? So in captive conditions, you can increase those species' typical behaviors by providing honey-filled bamboo stumps on trees, okay? Sometimes they paint the honey on the tree branches inside the enclosure. Sometimes they hide it inside, you know, they keep it inside bamboos. They close it, and then the bear has to crack open it and all those kind of things, okay? So those are the enrichments you need to do. Now, the dispensers, but however, sometimes they hang them from the branch of the trees, but the dispensers need to be strong and made of natural looking materials and have very small amount of honey inside, so that the enrichment cannot exceed the nutritional requirement, all right, of the animals. And such enrichments can be beneficial, like I said, for primates, especially who are very, you know, active, and they use a lot of their cognitive ability, and ursids and other small mammals, okay? So you might know sloth bears. Animals like sloth bears need to meet behavioral requirements for foraging. Now, underground feeding pipes can be very beneficial to them, and it can be used to increase their exploratory behavior, okay? Now, for in animals like ungulates are like toad animals, okay? Browsing and grazing are the primary requirements, right? If you provide in captive conditions, if you just provide a bundle of hay to them, they will eat it. But in their natural habitat, they browse and they graze around, right? So you need to enhance that activity, even in captivity, as much as possible. So when you provide browsing, feeding opportunities in the enclosure, the animals can be motivated to exercise as well, okay? And this species' typical behavior can improve the welfare and the competition for food, because they are in a herd, and that's what they do in the wild, like they compete for food. So you can enhance that competition for food resources in an otherwise impoverished enclosure conditions. Now, these enrichment can be used, like I said, for herbivores and also for species like the langurs, okay? Now, I hope you were all clear with that. We have much time on our hands today. I think we still have just around 20 minutes left. So I would just like to show you some things that, you know, might be interesting to you. I'm sorry, you know, I keep traveling to many places, but I usually just forget to take photographs. But these are some of the photographs regarding nutrition that I have taken. So this is an elephant camp in Karnataka. It's one of their elephant camps. It's in Shimoga. And this is in Dubare. And this is the elephant keeper here. And he's preparing. So the feed that they give, depending upon the region, even if it's the same species, it differs. Okay, like for example, here in Dubare, they're giving this grain and this hay. So they're making the hay. They make it into a lump, into a circle, and they keep the hay inside, tie it around, and then feed the elephant, all right? But in the same state, in a different elephant camp, they're giving ragi balls, which I'll show you later. Now, in Assam, they give a different type of food again, okay? So it's different the way, and in Madhya Pradesh, it's different again, depending upon the region and the food resources that that is available. Like I said before, the food items that we give are also different. But the important thing is is the nutritional requirement met there? The nutritional requirement that you have formulated, if it meets the requirement, then that is fine. But it also has to be palatable to the animal, right? Now, this is one picture, and this is another picture of, you know, this baby elephant calf also is taking this, and, you know, he likes jaggery so much. And if you give him jaggery, then he just comes just right at you, okay? So these are elephant camps, and I don't know if any of you have been to an elephant camp before. So these elephant camps are usually rescued elephants or orphaned elephants that are rescued and raised there, okay? And many states have these huge elephant camps, and these elephants are also trained, and they serve a lot for conservation, in a sense that when there are tigers or other elephants, wild elephants in conflict with human beings, they are used to capture them in the wild, okay? They are called we use them to capture all those with the help of them we capture tigers and other wild elephants as well. Now they are allowed to roam into the forest during the day. They go and forage there, and then they come back to the elephant camps, okay? So tourists are allowed to visit these places, and if you have any chances of visiting these, it's very, you know, enlightening and nice place to visit. All right. Now, this is another place. It's in Motigudu camp. So I've taken this while these people are preparing food for the elephants in this camp. Okay. And these are ragi balls. They are made up of ragi. So they have been processed into this, into a dough, and they're making the ragi balls. And around 14 people are there, just 14 people, you call them elephant chefs, okay? They're there, so just to prepare this. And so this is another camp, different camp. This is the Shimoga camp, yes. And over here, her name is Geeta. And this was last November, okay? And I've met Geeta when I was studying in veterinary college. I met her 10 years back in the same camp. It's in Karnataka in South India. And she seems to still remember me. So she's around how many years old? Maybe around 80 to 90 years old. So she's become very old, okay? And here is the ragi balls. Here they feed the ragi balls inside the hay. Previously, I've shown you that they have kept some grains here, right? But now they've kept some ragi balls. So this is a picture of another type of feed that they give, all right? And again, this is another type of hay again, so which they feed to the elephant calves here, all right? So we have 15 minutes, and my presentation is done for today. I think you'll be having your examination soon. So from the next class, it will be capture and immobilization and restraint. So it's very important. And I hope that all of you attend from now. There are 71 people. So I really want all of you to attend from the beginning. And it's kind of a little bit difficult. I'm sorry to say it. To go into the details, because you really haven't had your, you know, introduction to these nutrition courses. So to explain all this, I actually need you to have a basic information or basic knowledge about the nutrition, about drugs, about, you know, medicine, all those kind of things, okay, surgery. So but I'll try to make it as interesting as possible. And next class, we'll be having this capture and restraint, in which I'll show you the different, I'll try to show you in practical, like, you know, what we have done, okay, photographs of different species. Like we recently did in last December, just before the lockdown, we did a few leopards. And so we can, I'll show you all that, okay? It'll be interesting how to use a dart gun, you know, how to use a blowpipe, how to use a jab stick, you know? So you're going to need to do all this, okay? And how you restrain animals without anesthesia, how you restrain, physically restrain different types of animals. So we're going to get into all that. So it's going to be very interesting. And let's see. And very soon, I think, like I said, I'll come to Mizoram and we're planning to do a few captures on ungulates, sambar, deer species and other ungulate species. So if I mean, if it's possible to join, then if anyone is interested and to join, then I think you can tell me and we will try to find a way to include you also, okay? Now, let me just see the question. How will natural instinct of tigers catching and killing its prey is maintained? So usually they, in India, as far as I know, they don't feed live animals, okay? So they don't feed a whole body. So I think that they feed it in meat parts. So that way, like I said, you can use the feeding enrichment to enhance their exploratory and their natural behavior, like for example, hiding the meat maybe or something like that, all right? If we give raw meat to them, they don't learn anything. How will they survive without human needs? I don't understand this. Like I said, these elephants are elephants which are were in conflict, okay? They were rescued. So, and they need to be chained, okay? Sometimes, see, when we think only from our heart, it seems very improper that these animals are in chains. But there are lots of situations in which you have to chain the animal, in which you have to train the animal, okay? Like for example, some of these elephant species, they are permanent residents of places which have now become human habituated, okay? They have coffee farms, they have huge farmlands, and they are continually in conflict with the human beings. They destroy the crops. They have caused human deaths. So in those places, from those places, those animals have been captured and taken into these elephant camps. Because what you have to know is when animals are continually in conflict, it creates a negative perception in the human beings as well, right? So that causes harm to the animal. Like for example, in Mizoram, just a few years back, there was an elephant that was in conflict, okay? And with no second thought, the whole community of that village just went and killed the animal, all right? So in order to keep the animal safe, sometimes, okay, we need to do all these things, all right? We need to capture them and keep them in captivity as well, but trying to maintain their welfare and their comfort, that they get the proper nutritional requirements, that is also important, okay? It's not that we just get them and, you know, keep them in misery, no. But we have to maintain, that's why we are studying this captive management, okay? Like I said in the first class, it's a necessary evil sometimes, okay? Most times now, because of what, why did we say that we need captive facilities? Because of increase in human population, habitat degradation, we have talked about all that, right? So that is the reason why you need to know why captive facilities are also important to conservation and animal welfare. All right, I hope I'm clear. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. So how do we formulate the feed given to the captive animals? So there are certain, so each food item will have the nutritional value, right? You calculate the nutritional value of each food item. And then based on earlier studies that are there, you can get information of what are the nutritional requirements for the specific species of that specific age group, of that specific sex, or in which reproductive stage that animal is in. Now, after doing that, then you calculate the amount of feed and the food items needed. Okay, so in you will have a nutrition course in which you will learn to do all this. Okay, so you can apply that to it's so you can replicate that in for this captive animal feed as well. So it's all the same. Okay, am I clear, Kachu?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, thank you. So any other questions, any other thing that you'd like to ask me, like if anyone is interested in becoming a wildlife veterinarian or, you know, anything like that? We have 10 minutes left. So if anyone is interested, animal welfare, yes, you know, research or anything.
Yes, ma'am.
See, like I said, a wildlife vet is generally a person who is into wildlife, right? A veterinarian who takes care of wildlife. And most veterinarians do have to do that at a certain point of their career, all right? But the thing is that, do you want to be specialized in wildlife, okay? So if you want to do that, you can do it either by formal learning or by experience, okay? Which both of them, I find them important. But having a formal learning will be also very important, especially if you want to do go in a research field, you know, and if you want to go solely into wildlife only, I believe that, you know, you can do your master's in wildlife and carry on with that. There are different organizations, you know, that deals with this and on a veterinary front also, there are many requirements for wildlife veterinarians now. So especially if you want to go abroad, if you're willing to go abroad and do all that, then there's so many other courses that you can pursue. So yeah, so you can do that, you know, doing your semester vacations, start volunteering, you know, start writing to people in different institutions, you know, intern for people, you know, volunteer in the zoo, volunteer with wildlife scientists, you know, there are so many things you can do. So start from now if you're really interested. So even me, when I was in just in bachelor's, I used to start, you know, volunteering in rescue teams, volunteer in the zoo, lots of things. So you need to start from that, right? All your experiences will count. Now, Nishant Sharma, I hope I'm clear, Rana or Amin.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Nishant Sharma says, ma'am, what is the reason of tigers becoming man-eater in Sundarbans? So there are different reasons why tigers become man-eaters. You see, when a tiger kills one person or two persons, they are not man-eaters, okay? A man-eater is a tiger which has, you know, consequently, like, you know, regularly kills, hunts man for food. That is a man-eating tiger. So probably in Sundarbans, because, like, there could be a different reasons, like, you know, the location of the place and the type of habitat, it's extremely difficult for tigers, right? It's all swampy and marshy lands, you know, and the prey base population will also be a little bit difficult and all those kind of things. So there could be a lot of reasons why they turn man-eaters, yeah, and that could be one of them. Any other question? See, what I want you guys, okay, I'm gonna stop, okay? Please don't get bored. What I want you guys to do, to think is that, you know, where you really want to contribute to, all right? It's fine if you want to contribute to animal husbandry. It's fine if you want to pursue small animal, you know, practice later. If you want to become a wildlife veterinarian, if you want to do research, if you want to go to some paraclinical subjects, you know, and pursue research, you know, it's all fine. But the thing is that it would be good if you don't have to necessarily find your interest from now on, okay? Don't have that, you don't need to have that pressure that my friends are so, you know, particular about their interest, but I am not, I'm still not sure, that's okay. But keep exploring now. You're in your first year, you have chances. So this is your time to explore. The first 3 years, you can start exploring. Like I said, start volunteering. You are in a veterinary college. I believe that especially in Selassie Veterinary College, there are many research scholars there. Many professors are doing their research projects there. And, start volunteering, or, you know, just ask them permission to see what's going on and what people are doing. That will help you a lot later, okay? You're in your first year. So explore, keep exploring. Every year, you have different subjects. You're going to have different subjects. So you might have new interest every year. So that doesn't matter, it's okay. So keep exploring those, keep asking people, you know? So it's not that people are not going to allow you. You go and ask for their permission to see what's going on, what work people are doing, you know? And if they say no, then well and good. If they say yes, then that's good for you also, right? And if they say no, then it's just a no. Then so keep exploring and keep doing that. And then finally, you have so much clarity in your fourth or fifth year on what you actually want to pursue, okay? Instead of being unsure at that those last stages of your, you know, veterinary college, and if you're still unclear. So the people I know were like that as well, you know? People were still unsure what they want to do at the end, even by the end of their veterinary school. So I think that it's important for you to go and explore from now on, you know, like what would be best suitable for you, and what is your interest, and what will give you satisfaction every day after you start working. All right. So being a veterinarian doesn't always mean, okay, taking care of animals. There's so many things you can help people with livelihood. Even if you're not good with taking care of animals, there's so many things you can do. Okay. There are so many different subjects which you are going to be introduced in subsequent years, in the years to come. So there are so many things you can do, and just keep exploring, all right? And keep asking people, okay? And for all of you, you're always welcome to, you know, ask me or contact me for anything, any help or any guidance that you need, if I can give, okay? If at all I can give. So so that's it. There is a sanctuary near my home. Can I request any officials or researchers to join as a volunteer? Of course you can. Like, you know, you can. But the thing is that you need to respect people's workplace as well, and what kind of ethics and what kind of protocol they're following. As long as you do that, and as long as you show your interest to conservation, I mean, they will be more than happy to take you in. All right. So I think that you should definitely go for it if you're interested. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, guys. So thank you so much again. And I hope you have a lovely weekend. All right? And your exam is due. So just remember all those points which I mentioned, which are important. So so your exam questions will include your classes till today. Okay? You have an exam on 5th, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah, the exam on 5th will include the classes till today. All right? Is that clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. Have a nice day.
Thank you, ma'am.
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 Thank you, ma'am.